Hello, hello, hello.
It takes it a moment. It's may not even be live yet. The
No,
bean
I'm
counter.
sure. I'm showing 10 seconds.
Oh, well,
we are
you know
live.
What? You know what they say? It's coffee time. We'll do it live. Ha! Yeah. Wait, I can no longer play that because Arcfire has co-opted it. Is that fair? I don't care if it is. I think Caroline commenting on my title, Let's Fiddle Me D. She says, what are we looking at today?
Wait a minute. Katie, is that Caroline?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize it was Caroline.
Oh, yes.
Thought we had somebody new.
Getting it together, be there in a couple minutes. Well, yeah, I needed to, you know, I backed it up 15 minutes myself because...
Yeah, I saw that after I sent the message. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. I got time.
Yeah, I need a little bit more time, you know. Yep, it's me, she says. Yep, it's me. Yep,
it's me. Oh, how you care that? Rebrand. Okay. So, Katie.
Huh? Katie, yeah.
She said rebrand. So.
Rebrand. There you go.
I can go along.
Absolutely. With get with the program. Have you seen things like this?
In the bustling streets of New York City, where shadows dance and whispers of the supernatural linger, a new kind of hero emerges. Welcome to a city where the line between the living and the dead is blurred, and only the brave dare to confront the unknown. Meet the Ghostbusters, a team of fearless individuals dedicated to ridding the city of its spectral inhabitants. Led by their charismatic leader, they venture into the darkness armored with proton packs and a determination to uncover the truth. In a world where ghosts roam freely and danger lurks around every corner, they must rely on their wits and courage to save the day. But as the stakes escalate and the spirits grow stronger, they realize that the true battle lies not just in banishing the ghosts, but in confronting their own fears. In this city of shadows, where every alley holds a secret and every whisper hides a truth, the Ghostbusters must tread carefully, for the only thing more haunting than the spirits themselves is the darkness within.
Have you seen...
In the heart of a remote island paradise, where ancient mysteries lie...
Okay.
No, I haven't seen this. What in the world is this?
Yeah, I mean, it takes like modern day movie properties and makes them
and like slices them together with scenes of old movies and stuff.
I think it may be a use of AI where they, you know, yeah, old scenes, and, you know, rebranding and makes it look retro. It's actually pretty cool. This is Jurassic Park.
Oh, wow.
Where ancient mysteries lie buried beneath lush foliage, a journey into the unknown awaits. Welcome to Jurassic Park, where the wonders of science have resurrected creatures from a prehistoric world. Meet Dr. Alan Grant.
See, I would go see this. This is actually pretty. Is this not cool? Well, you know? Done in like 1950 Super Panavision, you know?
Yeah.
Paleontologist whose passion for discovery is matched only by his fear of what lies beyond the fences. In a place where nature reigns supreme.
Look at that. Larry, Moe, and Curly.
A man's hubris knows no bounds. Survival becomes a primal instinct.
Bee Gees, yeah.
As the majestic creatures roam free and the park systems fail, Dr. Grant and his companions must navigate a landscape teeming with danger.
Ah, now there's the spitter. I hated the spitter. I hate the spitter. You get eaten alive, paralyzed and eaten alive by this little rascal.
Yeah, blinded.
But amidst the chaos, they uncover the true essence.
Look at that high five. Look at that setup. Wow.
That's a really nice stereo.
Television in the middle, you know, with the little round tube. Little round screen.
That's pretty cool looking.
Yeah.
They uncover the true essence of life
itself. I want one.
A delicate balance.
Oh, dude, can you imagine having that in your background? That'd be awesome.
As chaos unfolds and the park's inhabitants prove their resilience, they come to understand the inevitable truth. Nature finds a way, even in the face of man's
life. Finds a way.
Finds a way. Nature finds a way. Yeah. Yeah, actually, those are pretty good.
That always starts, and then the running and the screaming and the blood.
Yeah. Blinded by the...
Oh, rotten little. Ow, get off me.
Yeah. Get off me. Quit. No, I need that. Intestines.
Don't
no!
bite out. Why are you biting?
I never made it without biting.
One, two, three,
small, large. Intestines. Wow.
I like the old timey narrator stuff, you know. Meet Dr. Ellen Grant.
Oh, the narrator is one of the best parts of it. You know, it's like, yeah. Well,
just, he sounds so very properly English.
Oh, you want to see Pirates of the Caribbean? We got to do that one. For family,
right? Sure, why not?
No.
Okay. How many of these are out there? Is this like a YouTube channel? Or?
There's several YouTube channels, actually, that do that do type things like this. Yeah, it's actually pretty cool. Batman. There's one just dedicated to, like, Batman stuff, making it look like it's from, like, 1920 or something. It's actually pretty cool.
Have you seen any of the Bat in the Sun channel stuff? They used to do like all superhero stuff, modern X-Men, Batman, all that kind of stuff. But they had a bunch of really good actors, and they were a group of stuntmen and women, I guess, that like put together their own little channel, and they would do these superhero tribute things. They had like battles between Batman and Wolverine, all kinds of cool stuff. But they were good. They were better quality than what they're putting out on the WB.
Oh yeah, you know, fan art stuff and things like that are much better than what the corporate's going to do.
Yeah, lately it seems like it, man. I enjoy the independent film stuff more than, you know.
Oh yeah, and you know, the avant-garde, the things that kind of move it along anyway. That's just not quote entertainment, you know, mind drawn entertainment. Oh, she has coffee and English biscuit. So proper. I think I love it. Anyway, Pirates of the Caribbean.
Ahoy me hearties, set sail for a world where the seas be wild.
Now, you know, they do the snap, crackle, pop, the hairs on the film and everything. They do it. That is so cool that they even they add that little bit in to this. I don't know if you can see it on your phone.
I know it's a little bit.
You'll get the light burst, you'll get the hairs, and you know, the crackle.
Ahoy, me hearties, set sail for a world where the seas be wild.
Now, the music here, I can't help it. If you listen to the just small little background, it sounds like the beginning of Gilligan's Island. So, this may not end well.
Ahoy, me hearties. Set sail for a world where the seas be wild, the winds be treacherous, and the allure of hidden treasure be a siren's call. Welcome aboard the Black Pearl, captained by the infamous Jack Sparrow, a rogue, a scoundrel, and a master of the high seas. Jack Sparrow, the rum-loving pirate with a compass that points to what he desires most, even if he doesn't quite know what that is. But beware, for cursed treasure, and supernatural forces haunt these waters, turning friends into fiends and allies into enemies. Hoist the anchor and prepare for battles on the high seas as Jack Sparrow and his unlikely companions navigate through treacherous waters, chasing legends and escaping the clutches of cursed villains.
Look at that.
Join the adventure, where every creaking mast, every clash of cutlasses, and every plot twist be a thrill on the horizon. Pirates of the Caribbean, where the pirate's life is never as simple as it seems.
Is that so cool, or why?
That's actually pretty cool, man. I wouldn't mind seeing some of these.
In a galaxy where planets are ruled by ancient houses and the sands of time conceal secrets beyond imagination, behold Arrakis, the desert world known as Dune, home to the most valuable substance in the universe, the spice melange. Amidst the shifting sands, a struggle for control unfolds as noble houses vie for dominion over this precious resource. But within the chaos, a prophecy emerges of a messiah who will lead the desert tribes to reclaim their homeland and control the fate of the universe. Behold the mighty sandworms, guardians of Arrakis, whose very existence shapes the destiny of all who dwell upon the sands. Prepare to journey to a world where the line between hero and villain blurs, and the fate of galaxies hangs in the balance. Dune, a saga of epic proportions.
Is that cool? I mean, yeah, they do Harry Potter, different ones do different things. You know, once you get on the kind of the retro thing, though, you know, YouTube will have recommendations. Just check them out, you know.
That might be one good thing that AI comes in handy for, is to actually make good versions of you know, big, intense books like that, that it's really hard to translate onto film, you know?
Yeah, yeah, it might.
That might actually be useful for that. Hmm. All right, no, I don't want to start accepting AI, no.
Well, one of them was, one of them that's one of the better ones is, and we've already watched some of these.
Hey, Chico.
Is Abandoned Films. Abandoned Films, and I'll make it easy for the chat. I'll drop the link right there under Bourbon Creams.
Bourbon sounds creams so good. I'm jealous. Coffee. I am jealous, Katie.
I have some cream of something in
another cup of coffee. Yeah, but what to wear when?
We've got The Hobbit from the 1950s, the Star Wars Phantom Menace from the 1950s, Avatar. Actually, there you got Shrek, you got the Avengers. And I swear there's one scene where they put Irving Forbush in there. You know, the guy with the pot over his head.
No, yeah.
I never watched Skyrim.
Was Skyrim? No, I never have either. I don't know.
Yeah, they got The Legend of Zelda.
I think that was based on a video game or something.
Mortal Kombat, just all kinds of neat. Now, there was one that did Flash Gordon, too. So I'm like, where is that? Although, you know, some of those aren't. It was kind of out there anyway. But
it's kind of cool, though. It's interesting.
Yeah, I guess we'll do the Avenger ones because,
hey, old Doc, what's up, buddy?
Which I didn't think was, you know.
I haven't talked to Doc in a while.
Hey, Doc. Skyrim, ha ha ha. Good morning, all. Good morning to you. Let me drop the linkage into the, if you want to come in here, Doc. There's the StreamYard, or anyone wants to come in. Make this open thing. I mean, look at that. Just look at the lighting on that Hulk. I'm sold already. Good, I mean, that's nice, you know?
But yeah, it definitely got to be AI, I'm guessing. But
yeah, but it's, yeah, I mean, it's,
I mean, well, easy. You know, Hulk is going to be CGI or something anyway. You know, there's no way to do a good, like, film Hulk, you know?
Well, like they did Avatar, all that's, you know, so why not?
Step right up, folks, and behold the greatest assembly of heroes the world has ever seen. Meet Captain America, the star-spangled champion of justice. Iron Man, the invincible...
Now, Iron Man looks a little like James Dean, doesn't he?
A little bit.
Yeah, the hair, yeah.
Invincible armored Avenger, Thor, the mighty god of thunder, and together... They are.
Now, I don't know. The Avengers. I disavow. I don't know what he's actually. This is weird. I don't know what he's doing there. He's got his hand down his pants, and his hand actually comes through the pants. Look at what Drax the Destroyer does.
Oh, that's Drax. Hey, okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So maybe Doc, he's a doctor. Maybe he can explain what Drax is doing here.
And together, they are the Avengers.
See, that went right through his pants. I do not know.
He was doing a self-prostate check.
Oh, is that it? Okay. But now, the Avengers. How he phased through those spandex-looking pants, I don't know. But yeah, this is the.
Well, you know, you don't want a swollen prostate when you're heading into battle. So.
That's right.
And what's Drax doing? Really, what's Drax? I guess.
Morning, Smokey.
I mean, why is Drax in the Avengers anyway, and Star Lord? I thought those were, you know, something.
Yeah, and they didn't. And well, they showed Groot in the beginning there too.
And Groot, yeah. I mean, those aren't. The
Avengers.
Boy, I mean, you know, it came.
They're Avengers adjacent. Yeah.
Well, right, this everybody's an Avenger.
Yeah.
Okay, now this is Spider-Man. Yeah. This is Spider-Man. You'll get a better look at him. He was the guy that I was thinking looked like Irving Forbush. But yeah, the old cars and everything is
pretty Irving cool. Forbush.
With their combined might and indomitable spirit.
Yeah, I was well, just looking did. At that old
there. There's Black Widow. Wow.
These brave heroes stand as Earth's last line of defense against the forces.
Or maybe that's Black Widow. Now that looks like the original Black Widow, except that she's blonde. You know.
Assembled in their secret base, the Avengers unite to confront threats.
Spider-Man.
Whoa.
That's pretty cool. You know.
Spidey's all
dead. No single hero could face alone.
And then we got Nick Fury with Hawkeye. That kind of makes sense, doesn't it? He's got one eye. Hawkeye. Yeah. Yeah, Nick Fury. Wow.
In the shadows are villains of unimaginable power, from the trickster god Loki to the cosmic conqueror Thanos.
Oh, there you go.
Each seeking to bend the world to their will. Get ready for a spectacle of superpowered proportions as the Avengers fight for truth,
justice, and
the American way. The Avengers.
Now, that looked like Irving Forbush to me. I don't know. It's probably Spider-Man. But I just
The Avengers.
Doesn't it look like he's got a pot on his head?
Oh, right there. Yeah, it does.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like Irving Forbush.
A thrilling adventure that will leave you on the edge of your seat. Coming soon to a theater near you.
I guess that's AI, right, Doc? Hey, Smoking Ray. That's what
Doc has already given up in disgust.
Sure, it wasn't James Dean. Yeah. Did Doc go get some coffee?
Probably. That or he gave up in disgust already.
Well, I just wanted to finish it.
I know. I'm just teasing. That one was kind of bad. Although that first one that you thought was Black Widow, she was good looking, man. She looked like a classic beauty from the old days.
Yeah. And I've looked at a lot of those classic beauty things, you know. I usually send a glamour shot because that's what Kate likes once a day. And I'm also looking for those classic Hollywood beauty and poses and things for like Lady of the Night and others. And really, I'm not taken by that many starlets. There's not that many that really, really, really impress me.
No, but I don't
know. That I think they were all shown in a better light than, you know, what they. Did you know Bernie Wrightson and I watched a documentary? It was a very short documentary, about 10 minutes. You know, about the 1990s King Kong that Peter Jackson almost did. I think 1996, something like that. He wanted to do it earlier than like his 2005 version.
Oh, okay. No,
Bernie Wrightson was actually hired to do some of the developmental art on that movie.
Oh, man. That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. I'd love to see that artwork. I think I've seen a piece or two.
I wonder if they still used any of that when he finally got to make the movie later.
Oh, yeah. A lot of that carried over. And a lot of the stuff that was in the 2005 was in that other movie, too. The cool thing about that thing is that it just showed you where it kind of deviated and what it could have been. It was going to be more like the Mummy movies, sort of lighthearted adventure. Actually, it had a pretty darn good biplane World War One type beginning, a different thing that deviated. Some of that made it into the like the Jack character, whatever his name is, Drac Driscoll or whatever, or maybe I'm getting the names wrong. He kind of like flies around in a biplane trying to defend Kong away from the Navy airplanes at the end when he gets shot at the Empire State Building.
Right.
Oh, my goodness. But
that actually made it into the game that they had out at the time. Doc, do you think that stuff I was showing, that's AI, isn't it? A use of AI?
Yeah.
I kind of like one of the few good uses I could actually think of for AI.
Yeah. It was cute.
I don't know how they do it. Actually, I guess they just punch all that stuff in there. Retro cars, 1950s, a certain time period or something. And maybe the computer extrapolates it along with the modern films like Hulk. And I still don't know how they do it. I would if they went all retro, and I think we're about due after 60 years.
Oh, look at
that. Put that in your coffee. Turn it up and now. What the hell? Oh, sardines.
Some sardines? Are those little sausages? What is that?
Oysters.
Oysters. Smoked oysters. Yeah, baby.
Yeah, baby. The breakfast of champions.
Doc, you are mad, man.
Now we know why he lost his mind.
We call him Doc because mad scientist is just too much of a mouthful.
That's right. It's shorter to say Doc.
I used to have a dentist like
I'm
Doc.
Using that. Shut up. I'm using
it. Yeah, no problem. crap.
Do you know the expression, Doc? Fiddle me D.
Almost. Yes.
And what does that mean to you?
Well, isn't that Scarlett O'Hara's line?
Oh, is it? Is that where Fiddle I got D, that from?
I'll worry about that tomorrow.
Okay, maybe it is Caroline or Katie, aka Katie, might know because that's her favorite movie. You're right. That might have been an expression. Did you realize that George Reeves, that played the New Adventures of Superman, was in that movie?
I did know this.
Yeah. I mean, if he only did that, he would be noted for that, you know. Mr. Typecast.
So good.
Yeah.
So good.
Well, I'm glad you're enjoying that. And I'm joining the little bit of lime in my coffee. Don't knock.
I just opened
right.
A
one thing's for sure, Doc.
I just opened a new can of coffee.
Yeah.
There are a few smells better than when you rip that.
You being a Navy guy, you can appreciate this. I will never get scurvy.
My cure for scurvy is key lime pie.
Ooh, that's a good call. I like that. You know, it was maybe the 90s before I ever tried key lime pie. I just never, was ever exposed to key lime pie till I was an adult.
It was a staple when I was growing up.
Yeah. Well, some of us are more fortunate than others, Doc.
Well, no, it's just it's a regional thing.
Yeah, I mean, I guess maybe it was just that. Now, I grew up on those little, was it Pat? Lemon icebox pies and the chocolate, you know, and the, I don't think they had a key lime. They
might now. I think there is a key lime ice cream.
They probably do now, but I haven't seen any of those. Of course, I don't go around looking at the frozen section a lot.
Me either.
But now one thing that's disappeared that I'm kind of distressed about and I've kind of been looking for recently is my father liked it and I like it too. It's probably my favorite ice cream and I can taste it now just from my memory. Taste the memory. Is black walnut ice cream.
Not a fan.
Yeah. Well, I mean, butter pecan you can find anywhere. And that was a good second choice. That was a good one that my father liked. But, well, apparently there's a lot of people like you that don't like black walnut, but I absolutely do.
Too bitter.
Look, man, I'm putting lime in my coffee.
Life's
a bitter pill, Doc. Deal with it.
I'm just saying, pal, pistachio ice cream, it means you're right with God.
I don't like pistachio, really. Ice cream.
Yeah, you're not right with God.
It's green. It's mulled green, Doc.
And delicious.
Yeah. Well, I could probably try it. I mean, I did try pistachios a few years ago in these sort of honey drip granola looking clusters. It was all nuts, though, with honey. Something. I got them at Sam's. They were pretty good. Expensive, but good. And they had the green nuts in there.
You've never just had pistachios?
No.
Wow, really? The pistachio ice cream is way different than just...
And I don't know if certain nuts are good for you, some are not, really, for your gut health.
I don't think pistachios are bad for you. I don't know. Sure.
I thought, I like cashews, but cashews are terrible for your gut, I hear.
Healthy is not a consideration in my dietary choices, sir.
Well, it should be, Doc, if you don't want to look like an old crone, an old hag.
So good.
Rex, we're like 5 days separated in age here.
A little bit more than that, Doc. You got your birthday coming up on the 1st of May, and mine is the 2nd of November. So there's a film.
I'm just saying.
Are you starting to get excited for your launch?
Hell yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, baby.
Launching next Friday, the 19th.
So here's the way that's going to work. We're going to start over on Anthony's channel, Dr. Gift Comics Presents, at noon Eastern Standard Time, 5 p.m. for my UK friends. And then when Anthony has to go on another show, we're moving the launch over to the Madness and my channel. It's going to be an all-day launch, all-day marathon.
I might pop in to say hi. That's fine.
Turned in the campaign page for Luke's approval. It looks
well. Now,
really
when good. You say all day, what does that mean?
From noon until I fall out in the evening at some point.
Okay. So no chance of getting you on the 4 o'clock shadow. Got it.
You can screen snipe me and we can talk that way.
You mean EFAP? Okay.
Yeah, we just stream tonight. Skyping.
Glenn, it's next Friday, starting at noon, 5 o'clock your time, launching a damn dirty thing. Yeah, I'm so
excited. Baby.
Well, do me a favor, Doc.
Yes.
Send me the link to your sign up again, please.
Can I post it in chat?
Sure.
Right, I'll
That'd
do
be
that.
Difficult. Sure. Why not? I can get it from there. Sure.
You will get, if you sign up and then you back, ladies and gentlemen, you get a exclusive trading card. And also, sorry, I got distracted. And also a discount code for your purchase. So we're playing on a damn dirty thing. The discount code is damn right. There's a tier called Damned If You Do and one called Damned If You Don't.
Nice.
Now, Doc, are you exclusively going with Fund My Comic? Are you done with all those platforms?
You better believe it.
Very nice.
I will never do business with people who hate me. And Indiegogo hates all of us. Just saying. Kickstarter, well, really.
Somebody over there does.
Yeah. And Kickstarter for damn sure hates us. All right. That's the sign up in the chat.
Okay.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, we had Kevin from Vicarious Energy sent you Archetype. Arcfire is his comic. We helped launch yesterday. And he hadn't even heard of Fund My Comic yet. I was like, oh, bro, you gotta get on board. This is, you know.
I have news on that. He's setting up his campaign on Fund My Comic now and says it's a lot of fun.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah. So he's coming to Fund My Comic here pretty soon.
Before you play
actually,
the trailer.
I guess I need to say to him he needs to launch that over here on this channel.
Before you play the trailer, Rex,
uh-huh.
I got to tell you a bizarre thing that happened yesterday. You've already heard people say, I died laughing. I laughed so hard I passed out.
Oh, shit.
We were hanging out at a backstage art stream, and John Dillard was one of the people back there, and someone said way back, but it sounded like wet back. And John Dillard said, what did you call me? I took my headphones off and started laughing, which started a coughing fit. And I literally woke up a minute later, slumped over, holding the headphones in my right hand. And I'm like, where am I? What happened?
Shit.
Wow. Like oxygen to the brain.
Yeah, yeah. So look, if that's what it feels like to die, bring it, baby. I'm not scared because it's pleasant.
Wow. Okay.
Here we go. Only on Rex at Chumpy Ass Theater.
Very cool, especially like the older legends.
It's good stuff. It's good stuff. I'm sorry. Oh. I'm still thinking about laughing myself unconscious. That was just never happened before, but that was funny.
Let us know if there's any permanent brain damage from that.
I don't see none.
Wakes up with an urge.
I don't feel, buddy.
I was disoriented. I'm still holding the headphones in my right hand, right? Uh-huh. And I kind of come to and I look at the screen and I realize, hey, am I live right now?
Calamity Jane. Yeah, that's a good one.
This is a backstage. Why can't I hear anything? Oh.
Now, I hear oysters are supposed to be good for your libido, Doc. Is that true?
Well, I mean, you know, I've got one of those.
Sex drive, you know what I mean?
I've got one of those libidos, Rex. It's kind of like a diesel at 100,000 miles. It's just getting broke in good.
Uh-huh. It's on automatic. Got it. You're married. You can do that.
I don't really worry about it.
Yeah.
No.
No, a real man doesn't really worry about it. I just wondered if that urban legend is an urban legend or if it's actually true.
I don't think so. From a medical standpoint, I don't think there's any.
I think it's more of a mental thing, I think.
Okay. Yeah, there's not really.
Eat oysters, get light. Got it.
Although you do, like, if you get really nice, good, fresh oysters and you slurp down a couple dozen of them real quick, you get a weird buzz off of them.
That's true. I don't care for them that way. I like them smoked or fried.
Really? Yeah, no, I eat them. My favorite way is actually stewed, like they do at Hooters, you know, where they're just like steamed. That's my favorite. I'll eat fresh.
Yeah, there's a place down on River Street in Savannah that they'll bring out a platter called a half and half, and half of it is fried scallops. Not those little round pre-made tater tot looking ones, real ones.
Yeah.
And half fried oysters with dipping sauces down the middle. Big old platter, man. I'm like,
that sounds awesome.
I told my family, you guys go on ahead. I'll stay here and take care of things.
There you go. This looks like a job for Doug. I think we might be picking up an echo. I'm going to pop out, come back. Hold on.
All right, then. I'm going to refresh my coffee. So
I was going to suggest that, but, you know. All right, Doc, you go refresh your coffee. And we'll do something else. Kevin Davis joined us. That was awesome. Yesterday, REM released their debut album, Murmur, 41 years ago, 1983. The Duck Factory, which only lasted one season with Jim Carrey. I vaguely remember that. Jim Carrey plays naive but talented aspiring animator Skip Tarkington. In the opener, he arrives at a rundown Hollywood animation studio looking for his first job, but it's too late to talk to the boss. His employees and widow are on the way to his funeral. And that is the setup for Duck Factory. Remember Duck Factory? Might not have. April 12th, yesterday, 1861, the American Civil War began with Confederate forces firing on Fort Sumter in the harbor of Charleston, South Carolina. So the Civil War started so many years ago, 150 something years ago, something like that. James the Giant Peach. I actually like that movie. Premiered 28 years ago in 1996. Aquarius, Let the Sunshine In by the Fifth Dimension reached number one on the Billboard Hot 100 in 1969. Welcome back, Shadowhawk.
Hey, what's up, fellas?
Hey. Yes, so this was number one in 1969.
All right. Psychedelic, man.
Psychedelic. Yeah.
Morning, Ellie.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Age of Aquarius.
Yeah, the age of Aquarius was a lot like the age of Ultron. It didn't really last an age, did it?
Yeah, kind of a flash in the pan one.
Yeah. Order now and you'll get A.M. Goldies.
That's
Elsie, can we hear you?
Coming soon to Just Off Broadway.
I don't know.
Jesus Christ Superstar.
We can hear you.
Yeah, we can.
Good morning to you, sir. Cool. Good morning.
Morning. How's it going?
Everybody.
Having your morning coffee, I see.
I just woke up.
Me too. Well, it's sleeping Saturday.
Yeah, it was. I slept in at 9 o'clock almost. That was
awesome. Quinn Fleming says, 54 years tomorrow since Apollo 13 had Houston, we have a problem.
Wow.
54 years. Holy cow.
Yeah, and April 12th, yesterday, 1991, American's first space shuttle, Columbia, launched from Cape Canaveral, Florida. How about them apples?
Yes, sir.
That one was actually successful.
It's not really the first. Enterprise was the first, but it never went into space. Yeah. So I guess it was just the shuttle, not the space shuttle.
Oh, right. Brian got, would you like to see his new cover?
I did see
John Dillard or his Six Gun Gorilla?
I saw it being made.
Oh, okay. Sweet, huh?
Very cool.
A John Dillard's a beast.
Very nice work. That Dillard is he's all right.
That Dillard boy can draw, I tell you.
Only 8 o'clock in the morning already, that boy ain't right.
I'm gonna tell you something. I hate him and I love him because I'll share images of my work with John and he'll say, "Don, why do you hate coming?"
Why do you hate what?
Comic books. And then he just crushes my soul. But he's pushing me to be better. So I appreciate that. I appreciate being held accountable by another artist. I just hate it when he does it because I'm like, son of a bitch.
Well, he's right. Get another to join in.
Well, that's the thing about Dillard. It's kind of, you love to hate him, you know, and you hate to love him. But.
Right. Yeah.
He's a good
dude. Love hate relationship.
He is a good dude, though. Man. It took me a little while to get used to it.
Yeah.
He takes getting used to it because he's got a heart of gold, but he's got a tongue of iron. he will hurt your fifis.
Wait, I'm copywriting that right now. The iron tongue.
That's very true. And you know, it's not like someone is saying something malicious just to hurt you. I'm trying to help.
Yeah. And he says it in sort of a pseudo pithy critical joking way.
Yeah. And the other thing is he'll do anything in the world to help you. When I was learning digital backstage with John, I don't know how to do this. Like, all right, Doc, here's what you do. Hours out of his time working with him, teach me digital.
That's awesome.
Well, then you picked it up fairly quickly, man, with your new setup.
It's pretty intuitive once you get into it. It's pretty intuitive. I've got the, let me see if I can share this with you. I got to share this one. This is just for you, Shadowhawk. I was missing Elizabeth Payne, so I did a morning sketch of her.
All right.
Isn't she lovely?
Yeah, it looks like she just woke up.
That's when she meets Jake Bishop and they have their little tryst. And what I was going to show you, Rex, is the reveal of the big boss Morelli. If I can find it. We've got so many things open.
I bet your desktop is a mess.
It is absolutely a train wreck, Elsie.
Well, I just I saw Enterprise latched to the top of a jumbo jet on its way to Paris Air Show in 1983. Quite a sight.
Heck yeah.
Yeah, I remember that.
Have you ever seen the Concorde, Glenn? Just wondering.
No, I've seen the Concorde, yeah.
No, I'm sure Glenn has.
All right, here we go.
I've got an Enterprise.
Hot Wheels.
Yeah.
That's a different Enterprise.
All right, so here we go. Let me find my mouse so I can zoom in here. There he is. The man is.
And who is this we're supposed to be looking at?
This is Vito Morelli, the guy that Jake Bishop's been after all along. Finally catches up to it.
Looks like a nice guy.
Oh, real pleasant fella.
Uh-huh. Sit down and have a cigar and a bourbon, you know? Nice little chat.
And a bullet.
Yeah.
Wow. And of course, he's ignoring everything, but we'll show it anyway. There you go. There's some of the glass painting that we've done in the past. That is Jesus and the apostles on the high seas, on the Sea of Galilee. What now?
I couldn't get it off of this pocket knife.
Well, I don't know why you would want to try, but sure.
I'm talking about the permanency of it. I didn't just paint on here with black paint.
Right. You actually paint on it, and then you fire it in a kiln, and it actually becomes part of the glass. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a you're painting with glaze?
Yeah, no, this stuff here is crushed glass, crushed black glass.
Okay.
And we mix it with denatured alcohol, and then we'd paint it, and we'd lay it up in the kiln and cook it for about an hour.
There you go.
Come out permanent. You can see.
Oh, that's neat, man.
And that technique goes back over 400 years. They've been doing that type of stuff for over 400 years.
We were taught the exact same way because that's the way he taught it. And he said, that's the way I learned it. And he goes, it's lost art, really.
It's kind of like wrecking the pottery.
Yeah, it's one of those things, like you say, not many people do it anymore. It's unfortunately, he suffered a fire in all his kilns and stuff, so we can't even do it anymore.
Yeah,
without buying into a big setup.
Now, Glenn is sharing that in 1999, he was the first civilian to land the space shuttle on the simulator at Kennedy.
Mm-hmm.
He got interviewed by NASA afterwards. But that there's a lingering question I have. All right. I've asked Glenn this. He doesn't know the answer. And I want you guys to think about this for a minute. The shuttle is attached to that big old cylinder, right? Takes off, flies into space. It's attached to it. It separates. They're in space, and then they come down doing the reentry. That means there's holes in the bottom where it was attached. And any hole in that heat shielding, I give you the Columbia. Hello. How does that work?
Okay, see, Elsie doesn't know that I muted him. He doesn't realize he was echoing. So there you go. Now, what were you saying, Elsie?
Oh, I was saying maybe there's some type of closure that closes
a clamp or something.
Or heat shields in the hole.
Google it, Glenn. He won't sleep tonight. And I may not if I don't
know. Even if you heat shield the interior of the recess, at some point something's got to pass through that and connect it to the shuttle. So that's exposed.
You're not supposed to question such things, Doc.
It has baffled my mind since the first time I heard about the heat shields.
Well, by the way, what does baffled mean?
When when Challenger exploded, about a year and a half later, we had a big tropical storm that hit Hunting Island, South Carolina. I went beachcombing. I found two artifacts that I sent to a lab at South Carolina University, USC, whatever the hell it's called. One was a bison bone, a bison bone.
There you go.
And the other one was this weird-looking tile that I could not identify. It was a piece of the space shuttle.
There's your answer. And while he does that, please fix that. LZ, back in the back, you're either that or roll that up and send it to me.
I was going to, but I didn't want to get up.
Yeah, oh, okay. Yeah, but that hurts my soul to see that great poster like that.
So are we saying that those attachments then just burned off on reentry, those brackets? They still had to be attached some kind of way.
So there were no hose, Glenn says.
It had to be attached. The whole bottom of that space shuttle is covered in those tiles. Something had to penetrate them to be attached. Just say it.
Well, maybe Glenn will have an answer for you beyond that.
I mean, I don't know. I'm not some conspiracy nut that doesn't think it was real. I'm just blown away that am I the only person that's ever asked this question?
Probably. Probably. That sounds like a dot question. It's valid.
Okay, so there were doors, is what he's saying, kind of like what Elvie said.
Yeah.
So, yeah, for years I had a little piece of the space shuttle. I got it framed in a shadow box and you can hang on the wall of my office.
Well, what happened to it?
Divorce.
She got it in the divorce?
Somebody did.
It's safer to say it was probably destroyed. Okay. All right. I guess I can buy that.
He may sleep tonight. Did this you read one, all of it? Because he's still going.
Yeah. During that divorce, I used to collect, well, I still do, collect movies. But I had well over 1,000 VHS movies. She took them. She didn't even like them. She just took them.
Oh, damn.
This is the same woman that destroyed my dress blue uniform and my medals. And,
oh, gosh. Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Ooh.
Wow. Damn commie, Doc. What are you doing with a commie?
Evil. 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 Witchy woman.
He was under a spell.
Man's inhumanity to man.
It's pretty bad.
So yeah, hey,
there's a Star Wars 1920 out there, and there's a Star Wars 1950. So that you know that they're both going to be different.
Yeah, they were replaceable. When I replaced them, the one that I kept on my son's 17th birthday, which was the age I joined the military, I gave him my collar devices for my battle dress uniform and my dive watch. If you ask him where they are today, he'll go, oh no.
Yeah, it wasn't a Rolex dive watch, was it?
No, it was Remington.
Okay, I started to say you can bought you a house. Going to get some more coffee.
Okay, so here's Star Wars 1920 version.
Rex, yeah. Mute him while he's away.
Oh, okay. Good call, Doc. Good call.
Yeah, I've seen this one. It's cool.
Ooh, what series?
Star Wars 1920s.
Is that supposed to be dark? I guess so.
Yeah, this it really doesn't have narration. It oh, yeah. Shows you the, yeah. Yeah. What it might have looked like if it was made in the 1920s.
It's actually, cool. It looks pretty cool, man. I mean, like I said, it's.
Check that out. Check it out.
I know. Yeah, I'd rather see stuff like this than. Well,
this better than what Disney's putting out for Star Wars. What the shit, man?
Yeah. I like the retro thing. I think there ought to be.
Yeah, look at that, dude. That,
Golden Age. Vibe again. People would love it. Retro.
All that cool background machinery and just the, all the detail in the architecture. Dude, it's freaking amazing.
Yeah, when, I mean, it's style, you know, it's, you know, an Art Nouveau type look in the 20s. That would be
cool. Ooh, a giant R2-D2s. What the hell?
Yeah. Well, you got to conquer the universe somehow, right?
Right. I'll just roll them over with R2s. That is cool.
And you know, back then it was all gears and levers and buttons.
That.
Look at that.
Wow. The Death Droids and what they call
Yeah.
Yeah.
All mechanical looking. Which is kind of what they tried to do in the Clone Wars, right? They went back to like War One machinery and stuff.
Yeah, they had a lot of, you know, robot stormtroopers and different droids that they would use for battle and stuff.
Yeah, see, I would watch this movie.
I would too. I would pay good money to see this.
Absolutely. Oh shit, look at that.
I don't know why there's so many R2-D2s.
I don't know. He's popular.
Because there's too many AI-D2s.
Yeah.
But the sets on this would be
very
incredible.
Very cool looking, though. I mean, yeah.
I guess that's C-3PO. I like the World War One helmets and stuff on the troopers.
Yeah. Turns out C-3PO was the mastermind the whole time he took care of the Empire.
That's C-3PO.
Oh, War of the Worlds. War of the Worlds would be cool like this. You did War of the Worlds?
They did do War of the Worlds like this. The original.
Maybe I just haven't seen it.
The original movie, you know?
This kind of reminds you of Metropolis.
No, the remake.
Oh, with Tom Cruise? Yeah, I don't know. It was all right. Those R2s are on a diet.
Yeah.
All right. Let me show you something real quick. When we end the show, guess what I'm going to be doing between now and 4 o'clock?
I'm scared to ask.
Never mind.
What? I had to get off that screen. There we go.
Boom.
Oh, man.
Yeah, but just came in. I watched the mail walk up to the door.
Absolute beast.
Dude, it's a monster. Look at the size.
The best inker that's ever lived, in my
opinion.
Wow, let me get to the screen where I can kick Doc. I mean, so not any of us ever tried to aspire because Gary's already achieved it. Nirvana. Got it.
He's the goat. He's the goat.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well, that's the idea. You have to strive to do better. I mean, than this guy does, and that's a hell of a bar to set.
Yeah, you're not going to be able to get there with a Sharpie marker, Rex. Just say it.
I'm not using a Sharpie.
It was a joke, Rex.
Well, there are some people that would do it.
Man, this guy does stuff with a brush that I've seen guys who use, Copic freaking fine point pen knowledge. It can't match the fineness of the lines and the perfect spacing. I mean, dude is he's out of the park, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's he's you know, gotten that control over after years and years and years to perfect his craft. Here's the 1950s version of Star Wars.
In a galaxy far, far away, where the forces of light and darkness clash amidst the stars, a timeless saga unfolds. Behold the epic struggle between the noble Jedi Knights, guardians of peace and justice, and the sinister Sith Lords, masters of the dark side. Meet Luke Skywalker, a young farm boy destined for greatness. Princess Leia, a fearless leader of the Rebel Alliance. Han Solo, the charming rogue with a hairy sidekick. And Darth Vader, the Dark Lord of the Sith. From the desolate sands of Tatooine to the bustling streets of Coruscant, from the frozen wastelands of Hoth to the lush forests of Endor, their adventures span the galaxy. But as the Rebel Alliance fights to free the galaxy from tyranny, they must face the might of the Empire and its fearsome army of stormtroopers. Yet, amidst the turmoil, hope flickers like a distant star, as alliances friendships tested, and the fate of the galaxy hangs in the balance. Get ready for a journey beyond imagination, where heroes rise, villains fall, and destinies are forged among the stars. Star Wars, a saga of epic proportions that will captivate audiences for generations to come. May the Force be with you.
And we got to do the Phantom Menace.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, the saga continues with Star Wars The Phantom Menace. Amidst the backdrop of galactic turmoil, the Jedi Knights, guardians of peace and justice, face a new threat that could plunge the galaxy into darkness. Meet Qui-Gon Jinn, a wise and noble Jedi Master, his apprentice, the young and eager Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Anakin Skywalker, a boy with a destiny that will shape the fate of the galaxy. But lurking in the shadows, this is a sinister plot.
Now, I have to say, these pod racers, which are supposed to be going fast, not so much.
Destiny that will
That's
shape
pretty
the...
slow for pod racers.
I like the design, but they need to move a little faster.
Boy with a destiny that will shape the fate of the galaxy. But lurking in the shadows is a sinister plot orchestrated by the Sith, led by the menacing Darth Maul.
Now that's cool. That's pretty cool. That's a cool look.
And Darth Maul really
manipulate galactic events to their advantage.
Yeah.
As ancient prophecies unfold and destinies collide, the fate of the galaxy hangs in the balance as heroes rise and villains reveal their true intentions. Prepare yourself for an epic journey filled with action, adventure, and the timeless struggle between the forces of light and darkness. Star Wars, The Phantom Menace, a thrilling chapter in the legendary saga.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
All right, so just going to say.
Star Wars is dead. Star Wars is dead.
It died the first time the word midichlorians came out of somebody's mouth.
It was kind of like it switched from faith-based to...
Exactly. It went from being a mystic order to, here, let me do a blood test to check how strong you are in the Force.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It took all the mystery and mysticism away from it. And, terrible. Terrible idea.
And I'll tell you another terrible idea that's controversial because a lot of people like Darth Maul. Darth Vader should have been the only Darth. Period. Full stop.
Well, I mean, that's more of a title in the Sith Order.
It became a title. Originally, it was just his name.
I don't know. I haven't read the original books, that it was all based on. So I don't know if that was part of the story originally or if it was.
Did you know that in the Alan Dean Foster novelization of Star Wars that's credited to George Lucas, but Alan Dean Foster actually wrote it? There's a line where Obi-Wan tells Luke that he took to wielding a lightsaber like a duck to water. And Luke says, "What's a duck?" And he says, "Never mind."
Interesting.
Very interesting.
Well, anytime you do a sci-fi thing, you're going to have elements of Earthlings and Earth, right? I mean, that's just our point of reference. So it's a fine line in suspending reality and...
Right, but supposedly it's a galaxy far, far away. So how did I mean, unless there's the equivalent of a duck somewhere on a super planet, you know, then we got to go into that kind of thing.
Topher needs to come on here and promote more. Just saying.
Yeah, he's backing me up. Yeah, Topher. He referred to Darth as Darth like it was a first name. Oh, my goodness.
In fact, of honor in honor of...
Well, exactly, but wait a minute. We all know his original name is really Anakin. So Darth was not his original name anyway, so it doesn't matter how
he was heard. But we, the viewers, did not know he was originally Anakin until Empire Strikes Back.
Right, until late. Like, I don't know. I think they kind of explain that with, you know, the Emperor... being the Lord. And the Sith Lord.
Power of the dark side.
Right. The Sith Lord only has his right hand man at training, you know, just like the equivalent of the Jedi.
Wait, before you do this, Rex, I'm gonna throw this out there. I ran into a wall in my story. It's not in the comic book, but it's in the novel. So I had the city, the fictional city that A Damn Dirty Thing and Pariah are set in is Solomon City. And the neighborhood that Jake Bishop operates out of is called Iron Heights. I didn't know there was an Iron Heights prison created by Ethan Van Sciver.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I was just going to say, dude.
Into that wall, and I've been trying to think of something just as cool. And nothing was really working, so I'm just going to call it the Heights.
What did you say the name of the city was, Doc? Solomon something?
Solomon City.
Could make it Grundy Heights.
Solomon Heights sounds pretty good, just Solomon Heights.
Well, Solomon City is the city, so the neighborhood within it.
So I'm saying a little inside play in Grundy Heights.
Star Trek was ruined when they just had to explain the
Kobayashi Maru.
Yeah. Oh, everything. What happened to imagination?
Amen, Glenn. Right. Amen.
Some things should be left up as mystery, just like Wolverine. Okay, Mr. Echo here wants to say something.
I was going to say you could call it Half Heights. You know how Solomon was going to cut the baby in half?
No. No. Get out of here.
Okay, you go back on mute, and I bring this up.
Thanks for playing, Elsie.
Thanks for playing.
Cheers, mate.
No, thank you. Winter Wonderland. Here we go. It's very quick.
Winterland is the story of a small college town in the Black Hills of South Dakota plagued with strange supernatural occurrences of all kinds. The town's de facto defenders turn out to be Winterland's brave animal control officers. I hope you enjoy this first issue of Winterland and will sign up for my Indiegogo. The book is basically done, but I haven't... picked any, you know, add-ons or anything like that. So if you want to get in early and help me put this this campaign together, it would be awesome. And anyway, thanks.
And then you can, you know, that's about a minute, and then there's about six more minutes of
who is this?
Of music.
Who is this? Whose campaign?
That's Topher. That's,
well, I was going to say, I like it. I like that raw art style. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very, I like it too. Yeah, he does have a bit of a long teaser trailer, though. It goes on for a while.
Yeah, now, well, he does the music, right? And Doc would actually like the music, you know, because he likes that.
Okay, so this is important, though. Panel and chat. Press one in the chat if Rex should spend some of his funding money to upgrade his internet connection. Or say
it's
amen.
All spin, Doc. It's all spin.
Raise more. Raise more money.
I know, right?
One in the chat.
Yeah.
Well, you know. And can I get an amen from the panel?
I'm not getting involved. I
ain't never changing. Never. Buy my book. Buy my book. Buy my book. Do, 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 do. Why is there this dual echo on?
Because I'm humming along with it. So Rex, here's what I'm going to do for you, buddy. If I hit my stretch goal for the audiobook, I will upgrade your internet for you.
We'll get there, Doc. We'll get there.
I'm just saying.
I'm just hoping it doesn't crash before that.
Glenn and I, and we have to do that as a whole book together. I'll write, you draw. It's Doc Fleming, International Man of Intrigue. Because somebody screwed up our names together on a stream.
Doc Fleming.
And both of us went, Doc Fleming. Oh, hell yeah. I started drawing reference sketches immediately.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah, I remember that. You were like feeling very inspired.
Yep, yeah, we'll have to do it. But he has to exist in Jake Bishop's universe.
Look at this, boys and girls.
Yeah, that's the Bernie Wrightson recreation, right?
Oh, yeah. My God, look at that.
Gary says he spent over 120 hours doing this recreation.
All brushwork.
Good God, look at that, man. It's beautiful.
What's up, Tree Goblin? Good to see you.
Oi. I am going to have such a nice afternoon. Oh,
okay, dude, well, we'll let you get to it. Join us again for the 4 o'clock shadow. 29 minute, yeah. Panelists, thank you for coming on. Going for a little bit over an hour. I have
Topher, I look forward to having you on my show to shill your book. Just hit me up anytime.
He won't do it. He hates everything. Hey, Mikey.
So, Rex, you'll relate to this. You know, I have a week's peace before I have to start the shill tour.
Yeah. Yes. Bum, 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 bum. Again.
Gird your loins, Doc.
Gird your loins, right?
Repeating the same talking points over and over and over to the point where you want to go out on somebody's show and just say the most absurd shit possible. So, like,
which is what Rex is here for.
I went on somebody's show and they asked me what was the revenge for that Elizabeth Payne was after. I said, well, she had a YouTube cooking show and someone criticized her chocolate cake recipe. If you just want to say something absurd.
All right, boys and girls, I've got to go cook and clean. So there, bow for now. Keep collecting.
Hey, hello.
Keep watching the stars and all that good stuff. And yeah, we'll have some more riveting content at 4 Central.
On Lifestyles of the Poor and Unknown.
And maybe Doc will come back on and eat some more oysters. Oh, my God.